Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, built with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Lay your burden down, every care you carry, and come to the table of grace, for there is mercy. Come just as you are, we are all. Is here in this
welcome to Twickenham. So glad that you're here. God is here in this place, and so it's a great time for you to reach out to Him with your heart, your soul, your hands, whatever you, just to say you need Him, you want Him, you love Him. So we're glad you're here, regardless of where you're coming from, whether it's a place of great joy and things are going awesome for you, or a place of great struggle, even pain or sorrow. It's a good, good time, a good, good day for us to be together. Glad you're here. If you're a guest, welcome. And if you're traveling, I know a lot of you are because it's Labor Day and a lot of our folks are gone. So we will just pray special travel blessings on you. You'll arrive safely at your destination. If you're here visiting family, we hope that goes well. We understand that it may not. So, but we'll be prayerful that it will. If you need us, let us know. We'll jump in. So if you're from town, you're looking for a church home, man, we would love to talk with you about how we receive new members. Just really glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. There's a card back of the pew in front of you. You can fill that out, place it in the collection plate when it passes a little bit later in the service. Indicate any prayer requests that you may have, and we'll be praying over those this week. It's Labor Day weekend, right? Which it's America, so what do? We have a holiday to celebrate hard work, right? That's just kind of our thing, isn't it? Pull yourself up by your bootstraps, do it yourself, DIY your whole life. And you know what? We are a really tired nation of people. We just are, because we try to do everything ourselves. We're gonna sing some this morning about finding rest in God, and you'll hear that theme through the songs, through some of the scriptures. I'll touch on it in the sermon a little bit as we talk more about going deeper in our relationship with the Lord. Here's what I'd like for you to do right now, though. I want you to take, everybody stand up. I want you to stand up. I feel like some of you were up late last night. You stand up. I want you to give somebody nearby a hug and a handshake and tell them God loves you. Let's just greet one another for a minute.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found. Dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Father, stand before the throne. Father, stand before the throne.
Beautiful words of rest from Jesus in Matthew 11.
Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Would you be seated as we take our offering?
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land. Alone within the wilderness, a rest upon the from the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day. Oh, safe and happy shelter, oh, refuge dry and sweet, oh, trysting place where
It's easy in the world we live in today to feel overwhelmed by all there is to do, by the struggles that we face individually, and by the challenges to live faithfully in a culture that is changing. Several of us attended a conference last week on ethics and religious liberty in the United States, and the secular world's view of Christianity is changing. In light of that, in light of the struggles that we experience daily, in light of the lack of rest that Jody mentioned, what we're about to do as we take the Lord's Supper is important, because it reminds us of all that God has done to strengthen us, to save us, to give us hope, and to give us rest. Listen to these passages from the book of Isaiah as I read them. They're as relevant to us today as they were to a nation named Israel in turmoil when they were written. This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. I am the Lord your God who teaches you what is best for you, who directs you in the way you should go. This is what the Sovereign Lord, the Holy One of Israel says, in repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and will not be faint. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this message from Isaiah, a constant reminder in the midst of change and turmoil and anxiety and struggles, you are in control, and in you we can rest. May our faith and our hope be in you and you alone. God, as we pause now to take this communion, as we remember on what Christ did for us at the cross, first we thank you for just the mercy and the grace and all that was done there, and for Christ's willingness to do this for us and become the ultimate sacrifice once and for all. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. with me. God, sometimes we feel like that we are in those troubled waters and raging rivers and walking through the fire that Isaiah mentioned. But we also know that our light and temporary struggles are nothing compared to what Christ did for us on the cross, as his blood ran red and our sins were washed white. God, we thank you for this. Strengthen our resolve to be more and more like him every day, and help us to keep our focus on the cross, our focus on Christ, in all that we endure. God, bless us as we take this cup, and help us to remember that incredible sacrifice and the grace and mercy that was offered at the cross for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Turn my heart. Glorious, marvelous.
good song. Yeah, I appreciate you guys. I mean, when you come to Church of Christ, you're in the band, right? I mean, because that's it, right? But you guys just really bless us. You really do. Thank you for leading us in worship. Hey, in your bulletin, there's a wrong date, because it's not the 28th. Today's September 4th, so we don't want you to be late for your taxes. Well, that's overdue. Hey, there's a brochure, Strategic Resources for Aging Well. It's a seminar that's coming up here in just about 10 days. It's on Wednesday nights. And you can take a look and see that is a very full program of resources and teaching and support and encouragement and answers to a lot of some of the issues that many of us in this room are dealing with, the aging issues and what happens there. You may not feel like you need this, okay? And you may not be in a spot right now where you or a family member is going through something like the kinds of issues that come with aging. But I bet you know somebody who is. And we're always wanting to find some way to invite someone into a walk with us and a walk with the Lord. And this could be that way, just to say, hey, I know you're going through this. We're having this thing at our church. I'll sit with you. We'll go to dinner. Come be a part of this with me. So take this, share it just with anybody you can, and invite folks to be a part of this. I think this is going to be really a good event, a good series of events. My thanks to Ken Smith, one of our elders, for really taking the lead on that. Okay, I was not going to share this, but I got a letter about a month and a half ago, and I wasn't going to make a big deal about it because I don't really like to make myself the point of stuff, but then I realized this would be a really great sermon illustration, so I'm thinking, who am I to stand in the way of a really good gospel message? And so I really tried to humble myself and get out of the way. And what I'm just going to do is I'm just going to read the letter to you, okay? I'm just going to read the letter that I got about a month and a half ago, and you can just, you'll see. Here we go. Dear Mr. Vickery, congratulations. You are the winner of our Average Joe Goes to Rio contest. Mr. Vickery, you are going to represent the United States of America in the 2016 Olympic Games in Brazil. You'll be competing with some of the world's top athletes in an event that has been part of the Olympics since their inception in ancient Greece, the marathon. On Sunday morning, August 21st, I told you I got this a while back, you and dozens of other athletes from around the world will line up in Olympic Stadium and run the grueling 26-mile course in the historic event. Imagine the thrill 2 hours and 20 minutes later when you run through the tunnel back into the stadium. To the cheers of tens of thousands in the venue and under the watchful eyes of millions huddled around their television sets across the world. We'll fit you with your official U.S. Olympic team uniform and equip you with your own customized Nike Zoom Flyknit running shoes. We'll partner you with our team of dietitians to be sure you are properly fueled for your run. And when the team arrives back in the U.S., you'll be welcomed with all the other U.S. medal winners in a special ceremony in the White House Rose Garden. Congratulations, Mr. Vickery. Bring home the gold for the United States. Warmly, Larry Probst, Chairman, 2016 U.S. Olympic Committee. Thank you. Thank you, young people. Thank you. Thank you. And a child shall lead them. So here was my reply. Dear Larry, you're nuts. These people are running 6-minute miles for 26 miles. I can't run a 6-minute mile for 1 mile. I'm 57 years old. I've got bad knees, an aversion to pain, and an addiction to chocolate chip cookies. I'm not even in recovery yet because I still think I can quit any time. And you expect me to run a marathon with 2 weeks' notice. Do you have any idea how long it takes to prepare to run a marathon? Months, not weeks, not days. Months, Larry. You're out of your ever-loving mind. Besides, I'm busy Sunday morning, August 21st. Some of us have to work, you know. Sincerely, Jody Vickery, Twickenham Church of Christ. Can you believe that? No? Good, because I made it all up, right? But not all of it. The marathon really has been a part of the Olympics since ancient Greece. It really is 26 miles and change long. And you really do have to train for months and months and months and months. And that's why no one will ever get a letter like that. Ordinary people don't just pick up and jet off to Brazil and run a marathon without training. Now I want to show you something even more unrealistic and unbelievable. It's a real letter, at least a part of a real letter, and it's addressed to you and to me. Dear human, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. That's from Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. Paul wrote that. And that's not a joke. And it's not even an invitation. It's a command. God really does expect average people to live every second of their lives, every day, as if they were taking the place of Jesus. That's what that phrase, "do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus," means. It means you live like you are standing in His shoes, or He is standing in yours. It means that it's like Jesus, you're supposed to live like Jesus has possessed your body. You act like He's standing in your shoes. You do exactly what He would do in any given circumstance. Pretend that you are wearing a Jesus suit every second of every day, and that you're going to respond the way He would respond in every situation. And if that's not unbelievable enough, Paul doubles down on the impossibility of this. He says, whatever you do, that's anything that you do, whether in word or deed, everything you say, every act you take. And then just for good measure, he throws in the word all. Whatever, word, deed, all. There is absolutely no escape from the demands of this one sentence command. Not a single loophole. It is exceptionally exceptionless. In every conceivable way, in every moment, you and I are supposed to live like Jesus is standing right there where we are. Kind of makes you want to write Paul a letter and say, Paul, you're nuts. The good news is, this is not the only letter that Paul wrote. We're going to take a look at some others in just a moment. A couple of weeks ago, we began exploring the idea of going deeper. We looked at this passage here in Luke chapter 5, verse 4, where Jesus asks Peter specifically to get out into the deep water. And then Peter experiences this remarkable miracle and is confronted with the holiness of God. And his life is totally changed by that. A lot of people think that's just the seminal moment in Peter's life. But we began talking about this, going deeper in our commitment to God, deeper faith, deeper trust, deeper obedience, just the whole concept of deeper spiritual growth. And just to kind of catch you up, what we've learned so far is that there are some places you can't go without a guide. And a deeper relationship with God is one of those places. You got to have somebody that can take you there. And what we said a couple of weeks ago is that Jesus is the person who can do that for you. He is your guide. He's the one that we want to follow. Last week, we discovered that you can do anything if the right person is on your side. A lot of folks, maybe even you, feel like spiritual growth is, you know, that's only for the good people. That's only for people who have it all together, and I'm not good, and I don't have it all together, so I don't qualify. We looked at one little verse last week, Luke chapter 2, verse 52. Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God, in favor with God, in favor with God and people. Jesus grew in an environment of God's favor. God was on his side. And what we said last week was, that's the sea we swim in too. God's on our side too. God is like the parent in the stand, leaning in, pulling for you every step of the way. God's on your side. God's grace, God's love, God's favor. We aren't under God's thumb, we're under the umbrella of God's grace. He's for you. God's on your side. You can do anything. The main message today is maybe even more hopeful. You don't grow deeper in your relationship with God by trying harder. That's really good news. I mean, it's Labor Day, right? And I'm telling you that trying harder is not the answer. See, when most of us think about spiritual growth, or what's come to be called spiritual formation, or even if you take an absolutely non-religious perspective on it, just becoming a better person, when we think about that, we always think, well, I just have to try harder. I got to try harder. I lost my temper with my kids, so I got to try harder to be patient. I get angry and I use golf words in traffic, and I got to try harder to watch my mouth and control my anger. I click on a website. I know I have no business visiting. I got to try harder to be pure in heart. I drink way too much. I know I do. I know I do. I got to try harder to stop that. We just over and over again, I worry, I get anxious, and I got to try harder not to be, go ahead and try that, see how that works. That'll drive you nuts, try hard not to worry. We just do that with everything. Do you know what that's like? You know what trying harder is like? It's like running a marathon that you have not trained for. It's like trying to bench press 300 pounds when you haven't lifted in years. Trying hard is like trying to solve the New York Times crossword puzzle that's crafted by the world's toughest cruciverbalist, and you don't even speak English. Trying harder in most spiritual situations doesn't work. It just wears you out until you drop to your knees and quit. In fact, I would say that in a crowd of this size, there are some folks in this room who have done just that. You quit trying. You quit. Not for lack of trying, because you tried hard. You have tried and tried and tried and tried some more, and it did not work. And now you're tempted just to phone in your faith and live at whatever level you've reached and hope it's good enough. Hope it's deep enough. Can I just show you three passages? Three scriptures, all from the same writer who a moment ago told us that whatever we do in word or deed, all of it has to be done as if Jesus were standing in your place. Same guy who said that shared some other passages with us that I think can give us some hope here. The first one's in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 and 25. Paul says, "Do you not know that all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? All the runners in a race run, but only one gets the prize. Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict trying." Did I read that right? I did not. They go into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Verse 24, he says, "I want you to run in such a way as to get the prize." In other words, there's a right way to run and a wrong way to run. If you keep trying and trying and trying to master some temptation or even instill some positive habit, and you keep failing and failing and failing, maybe you're not running the right way. Verse 25 is the one I want you to focus on, though. Paul says, "Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training." They're not trying, they're training. He is not telling you to try harder. He's telling you to train. You can keep beating your head against the wall if you want, but there might be a better way. Let's look at another passage, 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now this says, this book says Timothy as the title, but it's written by Paul to a young minister named Timothy. He wrote a couple of letters to Timothy. This is in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise both for the present life and the life to come. It's interesting, in that 1 Corinthians 9 passage, he said, we're trying to get a prize that lasts forever. And then here he says, this kind of training that I'm talking about has promise for the life to come. That's twice he's talked about that ultimate goal. The word translated training here is a word that I bet you've heard before. You know, preachers sometimes will come out with a Greek word and we just have no frame of reference for it. We don't know what to do with that. This one you'll get. The Greek word for training is pronounced gymnasia. Paul is telling Timothy to get into the gym if he wants to be a godly man. Godliness is not going to come to you, Timothy, naturally. You're not going to get it by trying hard. It's not going to just happen to you. You've got to be active, not passive. So you got to train. You got to get into the gym. Okay, one more passage. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Again, same author. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. It is God's will that you should be sanctified. We'll come back to that word in just a second. That you should avoid sexual immorality. That each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. The word sanctified here means to be set apart, to be holy, to be different, to be pure. And obviously, he's talking about sexual purity, which is a thing a lot of people struggle with. That may be one of the areas where you struggle, where you think, I can't go deeper with God because I'm a mess in that way. That may be one of your areas of struggle. For one thing, and I'm going to tell you, that's, I understand that, and it is difficult in this culture to be sexually pure. It is really difficult. For one thing, we're not supposed to talk about sexual purity. It's prudish, it's puritanical, it's out of fashion to talk about it. It's intolerant for us to hold to the biblical standard that sexual relations are reserved for a biological man and a biological woman who are married to each other. And if you talk about that, you're not just intolerant, that's hate speech. Not only is it taboo to talk about sexual purity, but sexual immorality is absolutely glorified. I'm talking about why it's hard for us to obey this particular piece of God's commands. Film critic Michael Medved, in a speech at Gordon College, said that he talked about how the media beautify what is not beautiful. He said, having attractive people do immoral things in sumptuous surroundings tends to make those activities look attractive. I mean, virtually every movie and television show you see these days, you got these ridiculously beautiful people effortlessly navigating the complicated terrain of human sexual relationships, and they're doing it in Hawaii or in a Better Homes and Gardens bedroom, and it's never awkward. And there's never any guilt or regret or fallout from their sin. Nobody ever gets hurt. And that's a lie, but we believe it. And so we struggle to stay pure, and we try and try and try. Look again at verse 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 4. This is one of the most merciful verses in the Bible. Each of you should, read this with me, each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. My favorite word in that verse is learn. In other words, you are not naturally going to be able to control your own body. You have to learn how to do that. You have to be trained. Trying has some value. Training is what's going to get you there. And we already know this. I mean, this is a thing that just, when you think about it, is. And I did it, I was reading that verse this week, and I went, duh. That just makes so much sense. Somebody had to train you how to walk, right? Remember, and maybe you trained your kids. You held their fingers, and they learned to walk. Somebody had to train you, and I'll put this delicately, to use the facilities. You had to be trained to coordinate your hands and your eyes and your mouth to feed yourself. You had to be trained to ride a bike or to drive a car or to hit a baseball or to catch a football or to kick a soccer ball or to find a golf ball in the woods. Somebody had to train you how to do all that. Nearly everything we do with our bodies requires training. Why would that not include the most intimate bodily act of all? You can't run that marathon, you can't lift that weight, you can't accomplish that goal without training. Let me make a quick aside to parents here on something. Moms and dads, we have the responsibility not just to teach our kids how things work, but how to think about sexuality. To make sure that we teach them that it is God's good gift, that it was his idea to begin with, and that when he looked down on Adam and Eve, he saw that it was very good. We need to teach them, train them how to navigate this part of God's creation in a way that honors him, honors others, and honors themselves. The thing I want you to see here is that even in a passage about sexual purity, Paul says you have to be trained. You got to learn. It's not going to come to you naturally. So what does it mean to train spiritually? I mean, we know what physical training looks like, right? What does spiritual training look like? Well, John Ortberg is a writer that a lot of you will know. He had a great definition of that. He put it this way: to train spiritually means to engage in practices, relationships, and experiences that will help us to eventually do by training what we cannot do by trying. Practices, relationships, and experiences. Spiritual training means that you put yourself in situations with people who will help you go deeper into your relationship with God, which sounds too simple, doesn't it? I mean, spiritual training means that you engage in practices, relationships, and experiences that over time help you go deeper, help you live more like Jesus, help you do everything, whether in word or deed, in the name of Jesus. What kind of practices are we talking about here? What kinds of friendships? What kind of experiences? Well, you're doing one of those practices right now. You are in worship, where we have sung songs about finding rest from the labors of life. We have prayed. We have gone through an ancient ritual, the Lord's Supper, where we remembered the sacrifice of Jesus. Worship is the place where you and I are confronted with the holiness of God. This is one of the practices that can help us grow deeper in our relationship with God. And it's one of the reasons that Scripture will say, don't forsake the assembling. Don't skip out on this. You need this. You need to be a part of that. You need to be with other people and be confronted by the holiness of God so that together you can all see that and glorify that and realize the distance that exists between you and God and why we so desperately need Jesus Christ. Worship is one of those environments. If you were in a Sunday school class this morning, that's another practice. You spent some time with people studying the Bible. A lot of us beginning, I think, next week or in the next few Sunday nights, we'll start being a part of small groups. We'll be training with people who care about the same things we care about, who are running the same race that we are running, who want to go deeper with God. We'll be spending time with those folks, and together we'll help each other become better. And if you're involved in a ministry, if you're serving in some way in our church, that's an experience that exercises and develops the muscles of your soul. Practices, relationships, and experiences. You know, Sunday church is kind of like going to the gym in a lot of ways. It's where you go to work out, to get stronger, so you can handle your business through the week more effectively. But there, and I go to the gym fairly regularly. I'm not saying I'm great at it, but I go, so I watch people. Maybe that's part of the problem here. I go and I watch people, and I've noticed there are two kind of people who go to the gym besides me, the people who go to watch. There are two kind of people who go to the gym. There are the kind who go there to demonstrate how fit they are. You know the kind I'm talking about? They spend more time looking in the mirror than lifting weights. They walk around in their fitness fashion wear more than they work out, and they pose a lot. They just do. And then there's the other kind, the people who go to the gym to train to increase their fitness so they can handle their business better through the week. And it's kind of like Sunday church. There are those who spend all week getting ready to go to Sunday church so they can show how good they are. Don't be like that. Be someone who goes to Sunday church to get stronger for the rest of the week. This moment right here is not the game. This is game prep. This is the gym. The game's out there. When we leave, we go out there. That's where whatever we do in word and deed must be done. All of it as if Jesus were standing right there, and we get ready for that in here. You want to go deeper in your relationship with God? Practices, relationships, and experiences are what are going to take you deeper. You can try harder if you want. You can tread water, or you can train to go deeper into your commitment with God than you ever, ever imagined. You can. God is on your side, and He is willing, and He is able to help you with that. I want to have a prayer. I want us to pray over this, and then we're going to sing one more song. Holy Father, we are so challenged by this idea that everything we say in word, everything we do in our deeds, all of it has to be done as if Jesus Himself were standing there. God, that's intimidating and that's challenging, and yet that's what You've called us to. So we're also thankful for those other words in other letters where Paul tells us it's not about trying, it's about training. Help us to train. Help us to put ourselves into situations with people doing things that will grow our souls deeper and stronger. God, forgive us for ever thinking that what happens in this one or two hours on a Sunday is the most important part of our faith. Help us realize that this is the gym, and out there is where we go out and handle Your business, being Jesus to the world around us. God, grow our souls deep. We know You are able, and we're glad about that because we're so weak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. He is able, more than able, to handle anything that comes my way. He is able, more than able, to do much more than I could ever dream. He is able, more than able, to make
mentioned this flyer earlier. This is plug number 2 this morning because we think this is a really, really important thing. Jody mentioned about the class Strategic Resources for Aging Well, mentioned that you may be in a position where this information can be very useful to you, and maybe you know somebody this information can be very useful for. And I'm going to promise you that even if you think you don't, there is every chance in the world that you may need this in the very near future. Our family never imagined that we would have to deal with somebody with Alzheimer's. And we applaud that this information is available and hopefully will be useful to you or somebody that you know, because it is a very, very difficult process. All of these things are very important. And so, again, invite somebody, talk to somebody, encourage somebody, and this could be a really, really good thing. We're glad that you're here today, and we hope you have a great week. Enjoy your day of rest tomorrow, I hope, and we'll close in prayer.
Would you bow with me? Father, you are more than able to do more than we can even think, ask, or imagine. You created all that is, all that we understand, Father, and there may be even more that you've created that we don't even know about. You are so powerful, so amazing. And we are grateful, humble, and thankful that you loved us enough that you would allow your Son to die for us. And we ask you, Father, to give us strength and courage and boldness. And being an example, being a help, being an encourager, being Jesus in the lives of those around us. Father, there are so many people in world who are looking for answers to the hurts and the emptiness that are in their lives. And you, Father, are the answer. You and your Son and your Spirit can fill that void, can change those lives, can provide freedom from the pain and the hurt and the guilt and the suffering. Help us to be your instruments of joy in the lives of others. For this special class coming up, Father, that helps meet the needs of those who are aging. Help us to be aware of how we can help others come to know of this class, to benefit from it, to learn how to care for those who are struggling and caring for themselves. And as they near that time when they come to meet you, obviously, Father, being your child is the most important thing in this world. Help us to be your children to the best of our ability. Through Jesus we pray.